multiplayer is hard, but it is also very interesting, and I want you to try it out. In this video, I will get you from the basic things to how a multiplayer game works, and I'm even hosting a challenge with prizes right now on my Discord server. More on that later. But don't worry if you have never touched multiplayer programming. That's the point, to learn something new. So I'll give you the resources necessary. If you can make a simple game from scratch in any language of your choice, you'll be able to make a very simple multiplayer game. You'll quickly see that multiplayer is more difficult than you think, but making a simple working demo isn't. And even if you don't intend of making a multiplayer game yet, stick around because I found the things that I'll share very, very interesting. The first thing you have to do when making a multiplayer game is to choose the protocol that you want to use. TCP, UDP, both, or a custom one. But for that, let's dive into the very basics of multiplayer programming. So the internet is basically nothing more than all of the computers connected together. Like, it is not magic, they have to be connected somehow to communicate. So whenever you access a website, there is a computer somewhere that gives you the website's content. That computer is called a server, and one message is called a packet. Now, in order to send messages, computers use what are called sockets. A socket is just an algorithm that allows two computers to communicate over the network. And there are two main protocols that can be used, TCP and UDP. And they are very simple to understand. TCP sends data reliably and in order, so what you send is what the other computer receives, while UDP just throws the data at the other connection. So why are there these two protocols then? UDP seems kinda useless, right? Well, the network is not a safe place. Whenever you send some data, it can easily get lost, or be received twice, or arrive in another order, or get corrupted. So this is essentially UDP, just sending the data. The only thing UDP does is to drop packets that are corrupted. The other protocol, TCP, will make sure the packets will actually arrive properly. But how can he do that over the same unreliable connection that UDP uses? Think about it. How would you do it? Well, it has to send a message multiple times, until it receives an acknowledge message. This makes it much slower. For a turn-based game like chess, TCP is a very good choice. But for a real-time game, UDP is a better alternative, because since things are moving so fast, you don't need to bother with lost packets, because by the time you resend that information, it will be already old. The players have already moved somewhere else. Plus, UDP is much faster. Now, how can we implement reliable things like chat messages if we choose UDP? Well, for that, you can open both an UDP and a TCP socket, but most games just implement their own protocol over UDP that allows them to send both reliable and fast unreliable messages. For this, I will show you how to use a library called ENET, and I'll be using C++. If you don't want to use C++ or ENET, there are also other libraries, so just skip this part. I still have to tell you about how a multiplayer game works, so you can make one, and the Discord contest. So ENET uses UDP, and it is specifically made for gamedev. You can send reliable messages, unreliable messages, you can have multiple channels, messages are always sent in order, even with the unreliable packets, ENET will just drop older packets for you, and it handles connections. Yes, for UDP, you actually don't have what is called a connection, so you can know if a client has left, and you have to implement that yourself. Fortunately, ENET does this for us. Also, keep in mind that the reliable packets that you can send with ENET are like a custom TCP implementation, but one that is made specifically for gamedev. So now, I will show you a very simple example of using ENET, just to help you get started. Don't worry, I'll also point you to some better resources that I know of on YouTube later. But for now, in the description, you should be able to find the link to this repo. All you have to do is to clone the repo, right-click here, click Open with Visual Studio, select My Game, here, and press Ctrl+F5 to open the demo. Quick note, this demo is kinda broken, you'll understand in a second why. What this example does is to connect two programs together, and allow them to chat like you can see here. Okay, and quick note too, if you find it hard to configure libraries, you can use this repo of mine that uses CMake, and it is in my opinion a perfect project configuration for gamedev, and comes with ENET already configured. You just have to enable it in the CMake, and call the ENET init function. But watch this video for details. So, let's get into the code. Inside main.cpp, we first initialize the library, nothing special here, and then we ask if you want to be the server or the client. So the idea is that the clients will all connect to the server, and in our case, where there is just a server and one client, they are equal in a sense, because they can both send messages to one another. We'll talk later how to architecture a more complex game. So, let's first look into the server function. You can press F12 to go to the definition. First of all, we need an IP and a port for our server. I haven't talked about IPs and ports yet, but to keep things simple, the IP is the address of your PC, and since multiple programs will connect to the web, we need one more number called port. And I just chose a random number, but make sure it is not a used port. Some port numbers are used by other programs like browsers, for example, when you, well, browse the web. Okay, so we have this port, and since this is a server, we can expect to get a connection from any IP. Then we create the server. We can specify the number of connections that we can have, the number of channels, and even the bandwidth limit. The channels are just different layers of communication, and they are useful because while the player is waiting for the world to be downloaded, for example, you can send some other data in a second channel, and it won't have to wait for the big packets in the first channel to arrive. We'll look at a concrete example later in the video. Next, we check if the server worked, and this can fail if that port is already in use, for example. Now, ENET peer is just a connection. In this case, the client that will connect to the server will use this variable to send messages to it later. Keeping the ENET server alive works like this. Inside an infinite loop, we have to call this function to receive messages. We'll look at how this integrates in a real-time game later. Note that you can add a timer that will allow the function to wait for some time if there are no messages. We'll talk about this later. Okay, so now we switch over the message type, and it can be a connect message, a receive message, or a disconnect message. If we get a receive message, we just print it. And if we get a connect message, we just save that client's data here. We assume that we have a single client. If we get a disconnect message, we just set the client to zero. Finally, if we do have a connection, we wait for the keyboard input, and we send that message. If we look at this function, it is straightforward. We create a reliable packet, and we send it. Okay, now let's look inside the client function, and it is very similar. We create a host, but we don't specify an IP yet. We check for errors, and then we connect. We use the same port, and for the IP, we use the local host. This just means that we connect to the same computer. Next, we check for problems. Don't forget to destroy the client host if so. Now, if we didn't get any errors, we need to wait for a connection response. And this is what we are doing here. We call ENET host service once, and we wait for 5 seconds to get a connection. If we don't get any connection, we print a timeout message. Don't forget to destroy the host and the server at the end. If everything works, we just have an infinite loop again, where we call ENET host service and wait for the user's input as we did with the server. This works, but don't forget that scene blocks the program while waiting for the input. This is not good. We want to continuously call ENET host service, otherwise the connection can time out and disconnect. Plus, we won't receive messages until we get an input from scene. But I wanted to make a very easy example, and I know that you might still be lost, but don't worry. I'll point you to a more in-depth YouTube ENET tutorial at the end of the video, and we'll also look at how to actually make your game once you have a communication going on. But first, let me tell you about the Discord contest. So, I want you to start and make your first multiplayer game from scratch. So, I'm hosting a programming challenge on my Discord server. The prize is a key to my Steam game. The rules are simple. Make a multiplayer game or app from scratch or using your own engine. You can use any language and any networking library as long as it doesn't do more heavy lifting for you than handling communications. So, you can't use a library that synchronizes the world for you and stuff. And the theme of the challenge is versus the world. And it's not meant to restrict you from doing something else if you really want to. When judging, I look at how nice the game looks and feels, but most importantly, I want to see interesting programming things that you did to overcome networking problems. And I'll also make a community vote, so there will be 2 prizes. Don't worry, if you don't get far, it is your first try, so any semi-working prototype means new stuff learned and hence a win for you. And you can join at any moment before the end of the contest. So, the contest starts now, with the release of this video, and it ends in 1 week. I really think you should participate, because, let's be honest, we game devs are lazy creatures, so without something like this to force you, you won't work at this nice project, and there is a lot to learn. Okay, now, forget about the details of ENET for a second. Imagine you got a connection, and you can send packets between the server and the clients. Now what? Well, the first thing to consider is the server architecture. What I recommend is to have a server that is responsible for synchronizing all of the players. Now, the player that starts the server will also be a client to that server as well. So, the server should be easily placed on another thread, but for simplicity, you can also run the server on another program. Now, the server will be made in the same language as your client. I think this is just easier, as you will see shortly. So, let's look at a concrete example. This is my latest Minecraft clone, and it is multiplayer. The server will generate the world, and it will just send it to all of the players as reliable packets. Now, whenever any player breaks or places a block, it will just send a packet to the server to tell it to change the world state, and the server will inform all of the other clients of that change. The gameplay structure will look like this. We just have the game loop, and we first call the ENET function, and then we update the game as normal. We don't wait for packets if there are none, because we have to update the game. For the server, you can wait for packets if you don't have anything else to do. I'll soon release videos where I explain how the multiplayer in my Minecraft clone works in depth, so subscribe to not miss that. But for now, I will mention that the server has two threads, one to get ENET updates as fast as possible, and one to do the work. You can easily do it with only one though. I also use two separate channels for updating the world and updating the player's position. I want to keep player movement smooth, because that is noticeable, unlike getting chunks a few milliseconds late. Now, players will just be assigned a unique ID, so you can easily refer to each other. When you connect, you have to implement what is called a handshake. And basically, the server will just send you a reliable packet with your client ID and some other info like maybe your position in the world or all the other connected clients. The client just waits for that first packet and then the game can begin. Now, let's look at common problems. First of all, you can't send a ton of data every frame. This would just flood the network. You usually have to send changes rather than the entire state of the world. So, be careful how you structure your data. For example, if you have multiple reliable channels, they can be received independently. Make sure your game doesn't break if you receive some other packets from other channel before you get your first handshake message. Or make sure that can't happen. Now, the connection will take time to arrive, so you can't just update every player when you get their new position. You need to simulate the entire world on the client, and the server has the role to correct them. So, since the clients and the server will run the same simulation code, you can see that it is easier to make the server in the same language, because you write the same code only once. So, in this old project of mine, I send the player information only when I press another keyboard button, and I simulate each player individually in the same way on each client, including the client's player. So, the current player and the other players are simulated and treated equally, and the server will update from time to time the other players. I send these packets unreliably, because otherwise it causes too much lag, and this can mean that I could have problems. So, I also send the player's information a few times per second, even if I don't change the state of the input, just to make sure everyone is synchronized. Competitive games also need to validate input. So, for example, if you shoot a player, the server is the one to check if that player was actually hit. Valorant uses fixed sticks to fix this, for example. So the gameplay simulation runs at fixed intervals, and when a player shoots, it tells the server their shoot position along with the simulation timestamp. So the server can look back in time and correct it. Now, this can get tricky to implement. So for my simple game, I just say that if a client was able to hit an enemy on his simulation, that is registered as a hit, and it is a good enough start. Now, another problem is what happens when some packets are late, making the other players stop. To account for this, games usually delay the other player's position updates by a few frames. It's exactly how YouTube video works. If your connection is lost for a few seconds, you won't notice it, because you have a few seconds of video already loaded. This is called buffering. Now, of course, for this first prototype, don't worry if you don't manage to implement this fancy stuff. You just have to implement something basic, but keep in mind that these problems exist. I'm telling you this because you won't initially see them when testing your game locally. When testing your game on your own PC, you won't have any lag problems. When I tested my multiplayer game first on two computers, it lagged a ton, because I was sending too much data. Now, a guy from my Discord found this library that can also simulate network latency, but there are also external tools, like this one, that can simulate network latency if you want to test it. So, finally, I have resources on my Discord server and I update them frequently. But for now, check out this video by User Games that is a very good ENET tutorial. And join my Discord contest, and if you are lazy, check out my multiplayer Minecraft project. See you!